you know, it's like a some kind of military, it's either like a master team or it's just some kind of, you know, whatever, right? Some kind of crowd control gas, right? Doesn't really matter so much. But what I find strange here, maybe I'm wrong here. Maybe I'm wrong here. It's immediately here. I don't think this is in the manga at all, honestly. So maybe I'm wrong here. I haven't read this chapter for a while now, but I just don't have any memory at all of them showing actually Marley soldiers in paradise. This seems like a plot hole because this logistically is really hard for them to do, right? So the thing is that in the next scene after this, we do see Beskar Peak, right? She's behind them. And of course, Peak is the mule, right? She has all this stuff on her. So it makes sense that she would bring this stuff to Zeke, and then Zeke would, you know, use the gas thing, and then he would scream, and that stuff, right? That makes sense, right? That's fine. This is how they created this, you know, Connie's village to compile it, it's like Connie's mom and so on. That makes perfect sense. But the thing is that the Marleys, and maybe I'm wrong, right? Maybe there is some scene in the Marley solitude, but I have no memory of that, and it seems weird to me, that the Marley actual, this place here is in the middle of the second place. This is like, you know, wall two, right? Which means that the Marley army would have to somehow get to this place. And that's never been shown in the manga. Because it doesn't make any sense, honestly. It's almost like a plot hole. Because the thing is that the Marleys, they have this base right at the ocean, right? That's called the destroyed in the timescape where you see kind of when they get this one, right? So what this means here is that the Marley would have to, maybe like, I don't know, mount on peak, like ride on peak or something, to get to this place. And this is, things that it's kind of, it's kind of hard for the Marleys, from like a military standpoint, just like a normal army, right, to move, right, from the ocean to the first wall. As we know with the warriors, with, you know, Ymir, right, it's hard for them to move that area because there's so many titans running around, right, between the ocean and the first wall. And then as they destroy the first wall, or at least part of it, the second area is also kind of scary, right? So they never had units, like the actual Marley soldiers has never been, you know, moving between the ocean and like wall two or three, right? Because they're kind of like standing at the edge, right? Bringing over aliens and, you know, throwing them down to create more, you know, titans, right? So it's like a really weird, like, thing, honestly. And I'm pretty sure this is not in the manga, or definitely not sure this is in the manga. Maybe I'm wrong on that thing, but I was kind of with the manga to compare it because it seems weird to me that they're even showing that, like, several people, not just like one person with Peak, but like, it's like a, you know, like a small army squad here or whatever, or at least like 10 people. There's more people next in. So you don't know exactly how many they are, but it seems way too many to me. We see three more people there, they have this gas thing on them. We see Peak and, you know, Zeke, and they're like, yeah, scream now. That seems like, and it's also kind of unnecessary because Peak can carry so much stuff. Peak could have carried that gas anyway to Zeke, right, and give him the stuff. They didn't need these army guys to, like, you know, Peak is obviously very intelligent. She could probably utilize his military stuff anyway. So I don't know why the army necessarily suddenly. There's like a strange scene, honestly, to me. And I don't think there's ever really been shown like that in the manga that they brought in like half an army to help them out with this strategy. Like, what's even the point then? Because the whole idea is that Zeke and Peak, you know, the village, right, against, you know, the aliens, and that's why they don't really need, you know, that's why they don't need these people, right? So it's kind of weird, even. It is true the Zeke is lying about stuff, but this I don't feel is a lie, because I think this thing is more like him explaining to the viewer. This is more like, I feel like a God of Voice thing, where Zeke is not lying to him, because he's like, this is how I did it, right? Because this is kind of how it's powered, kind of. It is true, though, that they do it in another way, but still, it's like, I think it's a weird way that, but I guess it's true that, I guess you could be right on that, that Zeke is just like lying about the army being there, but I don't know, it feels like a weird way to show that it's a big army suddenly, just from like how it actually, like what's the point of that, but anyway, let's get all the part of the dream is more interesting, yeah, so, I love this scene, my god, I love it, Flosh is like, I would never forgive her, it's like, come on, yeah, Flosh is not part of forgiveness squad. He would have killed Gabi immediately. Yeah, so anyway, I mean, the episode general, right, is about that Gabi, of course, is going to be protected by Plot Dom, right? No, but, of course, the end of the episode, again, is about Gabi. Gabby's the new main character. I keep saying it, like, Eren has way less screen time than Gabi. Absolutely. Eren has, like, a tenth of her screen time. But whatever. As we saw earlier, of course, Gabi meets Sasha's family. Of course, Gabi meets Sasha's, like, the girl she saves in two, right? just like Onesha and Sasha, and of course also you know, Nikolai and so on, right? And you know, that general thing, right? That Sasha, or basically everyone involved with Sasha, is at this place, right? And that really annoys me, honestly, right? It really annoys me, because I keep saying in reaction, but I really do feel that the world is this tiny, right? Like, it's just this tiny, yeah. Like, of course Sasha, this is her parents, of course they're going there. Of course the chef that they're going to is the guy that loves Sasha. Of course Aaron and Floch appears, like, I do that Floch thing, but yeah, of course Floch and Aaron and so on. Of course they appear at the exact same time Gabby's there to have this scene with her and Falco and so on, right? And of course then Gabi happens to be in the place where Aaron is to explain the real reason to, you know, Mikasa and so on. So I think that's kind of funny too. It's just like, oh, of course Gabi has to be in this like super important meeting between the main characters, and she's all like, you know, oh my god, what's happening? How did I get in here and so on, right? Did you see what I mean? Like, it really is that Gabi has to be in every goddamn scene in this season. It's like, oh, of course Gabi's in the room with Aaron. Yeah, like, why? She brings nothing to this discussion, but she's there. And so on, right? So anyway, the whole idea of, you know, forgiving Gabi is quite stupid, right? Generally, I said earlier in the directing part, I would have loved if Kaya would have gotten her. I would have loved it, right? If Kaya was like, ah, damn, I win. You know? Because she introduces Gabi to the notion that, oh, I know you from Molly, right? But I want to forgive you because my mom died. But that, you know, forgiveness and everything and that stuff, right? And then she's like, oh, you killed Sasha? Oh, no, I'll kill you. So I liked that she, of course, actually goes against her previous beliefs, right, about forgiveness. But Sasha's parents are like, nah, why would you want revenge or something? Or, I don't know. Something for that, and it really isn't well motivated, I feel, not at all. You can, of course, I mean, people are different. Some people, of course, are you know, gonna be more forgiveness, right? But the thing is that I think it's a big issue here that we haven't really seen that much of her parents, of Shada's father and so on, and it just feels very inhuman, honestly. I think that he's like, oh, you killed my daughter, ah, whatever. You know, like, we haven't really had that build up of him being this like very stoic, very like, I don't know, fair and very like, I don't know, logical and having no emotions, having no, and the thing is that from a normal human standpoint, right, most humans, of course, has different degrees of impulse control, right, and that usually measures your heat of passion kind of crime, right? So I mean, the normal reaction, right, I think, would be that, oh, you killed my daughter and you will go crazy. Right? This is the bastard who killed my daughter and you will go crazy. That's kind of is the expected, I would say, human behavior, unless you're like a psychopath, basically, right? So basically, it's like, oh, here's the person who killed my daughter, but who cares, man? Who cares? But they are oh, god damn it. It's not about her age, man. It's about them being, of course, and that's like the worst excuse ever. It's about them being, of course, soldiers. She's still in the military. But she's like, whatever, right? Whatever. And also, their daughter was in the military before when she was a kid, too, so it doesn't make any sense. But people can always make these stupid excuses for why we should get revenge, right? But regardless of that, though, regardless of how you want to measure Gabby's status or whatever, her parents, or her parents, but Sasha parents, should have any kind of emotional impact, right? But they don't. So basically, her parents are psychopaths. Yeah, her parents are psychopaths because they don't have any emotional, they have like no emotional, you know, reaction to it. They're like, oh, okay. Right? They're like, whatever. The father is like, no. He stays perfectly calm. And this is like basically almost impossible to do unless you're psychopath. So that's the only way you can reason this scene, is that, yeah, her parents are complete, you know, 100% logical psychopaths. That's the only way you can put it. They have no impulses, right? That's the only way you can argue that they would be like, no, yeah. And the thing is that knowing Sasha, being this, you know, best girl, wild eater girl, being all over the place, right? She's basically the opposite of her parents. Then. Sasha would probably very much kill Gabi, right? This is the role reversed. So it's like, okay, so Sasha is then the complete opposite of her parents. I mean, interesting. So no, the whole characterization of her family and so on is just, it's just, as always, that is just, that doesn't make any sense. And I think it does, and I do feel it's cringe that it's always, again, right, that, of course, Gabi has to meet everyone. Gabi has to meet, and Falco has to save her. Mikasa has to save her, right? And she's so bad reading people, right? She's like super good at everything except reading people. And he's like, so you know, I killed her, awesome! It's like, okay. And Falco's like, no, Gabi, read the context, read the situation, right? But as always, she doesn't, right? She's perfect at everything except that. And then Floch finally appears and is like, okay, let's start the actual Jaggery's thing. So the Floch team was great. Yeah, the ending is great. Floch entering there, and I am definitely looking forward to Eren, of course, being like, okay, let me explain to you what I really feel about your Mikasa. That's like, it's a really good portion. I think we're kind of out of the bad stuff now. We kind of had the most of the Gabi's forced character development and all of the goddamn scenes that just make the anime worse. And now we're finally into Eren actually being more of the main character again. So I can get over that. So I think we're going to get into the highlights now, next episode, definitely. But anyway, so you guys saw on Twitch, we're going to read the manga there, and of course also do Tenshi, and then do Nonion Byaru afterwards. So subscribe, and have a good day.